This is Ham Radio Now, as always, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this is our generic introduction to one of the 2017 ARL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference talks. The DCC was held in St. Louis in September 2017. Who knows what year it is when you're watching this? Okay, let's roll in the title. And you can see which one of the talks it is right down there in the title. If you're listening to the audio podcast, well, your app already gave you the title. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I produced and edited the DCC video series and stood there with the camera recording them all. And the only reason to record this introduction at all is to ask you for money. I didn't run a Kickstarter to support producing the DCC videos this year, and with travel, hotels, equipment, editing time, they get kind of expensive to produce. So I'm asking you to make a contribution to Ham Radio Now to pay me for doing them. It's pretty easy. Just go to the website, hamradionow.tv, do the click here to enter thing, and then when you get there, click the pig. That's Arvin, our chief financial officer and our mascot. And you get to our contribution page. And then you got three options. There is the Patreon, which sets up a monthly contribution. That's something that's good if you're generally supporting Ham Radio Now all year long. Maybe not if you want to do the Tapper Conference. If you want to just do a one-time contribution, then it would be this credit card. And you can click on the donate button. Or if you've got a PayPal account, it's also good for a one-time contribution. You can use a credit card in PayPal as well. And finally, the Kickstarter's always offered a $150 level contribution, for which you got this little USB drive with all of the programs on it in high definition video. So typically, well, last year was a 64 gigabyte USB 3 USB drive. So it was a pretty good high quality one. Without the Kickstarter, there's still a way to do that. It's through the PayPal. And you just open that up and go down to this level, the $150 level, and get the DCC USB drive. And I'll see that you've ordered that or made a contribution for it. And when all the programs are done, then you'll get that. Back to the website for a second. Take a look up here at the top. If you want a link to all of the DCC videos going all the way back to 2008, we've got them here on the website. It's right under the episodes menu. Look down here and you'll see Tapper DCC. Let me bring that up to full screen. You see Tapper DCC. And if we switch on that, then there's, several links. There's the DCC videos from 2011 to the present. Those are the ones that went straight to YouTube. There are DCC videos from 2008 and 2009. And those are the ones that we did on DVD back in the day when that was the thing. And I didn't do the DCC in 2010, but there are DVDs available, and this link will take you to them, and you can buy them directly from Tapper. So let me take a look at one of the YouTube playlists, and you can see what that looks like. This is just a simple, it was the easiest way for me to put together a list of things from the Tapper conferences. And you'll also notice that there's a few programs that are not necessarily DCC, but that I thought you might be interested in. There's the Tapper Banquets, Tapper Forums from Dayton, and like this program here, Carl Laufer's RTL SDR program. That was something we recorded from Dayton. It wasn't a Tapper talk, but something that I think you guys would be interested in. One last thing. Tapper and I would like these programs to reach every ham who might be interested in them. And that is harder than you might think. There's a lot of media out there, and it is all competing for your attention. So you can help by spreading the word to your friends in real life and in social media like Facebook and Twitter. In real life, you know, maybe mention them at a radio club meeting or on a net, or put a notice in your club newsletter. Just you get the word out as best you can. That would be a really, really helpful thing for you to do for us. And the best place to point people is to the hamradionow.tv website, or more specifically to hamradionow.tv slash TAPR-DCC. And that'll get people there. All right, let's go to St. Louis and whichever Tapper talk this is.
You ready, David?
Yeah, sure.
All right. Okay. You want to test it out?
I think everybody can hear me because
okay.
I have an echo.
I can certainly hear you. Can you hear David? Yeah. All right. Sounds good. So let's make some introductions here for David next up here. So David Byrne, W2LNX, and his topic of ham radio education, testing, and training. Take it away, David.
Well, I don't feel so bad about the mess because it's a perpetual problem maintaining all your information. So that was a good presentation. So I'm David, W2LNX, and this is actually my fourth time here. So a couple of weeks ago, I got email from Mel and from Steve to invite me to do a talk. What have you been doing since 2014? Well, in 2014, I was asked to take over the education committee of the Montgomery Amateur Radio Club when the president, Alex, W3JAG, when she was doing the education stuff, and then she became president, so she asked me to take over. So that's what I've been doing since then. So Steve said, why don't you present on that? So I'm going to talk about marketing, and actually you'll see a flow from beginning to end, first contact with people to getting their ham license, and then actually doing something with it, because a ham license is really a learner's permit. I don't know if anybody knows how to drive a car after they take a written test and they've never been behind the wheel. So let's talk a little bit about marketing. So I always walk around, whatever event I do, if there's a possibility of people being there, parks, public workshops, I put on my ham radio hat. And so I always have flyers, cards, you'll see some screenshots of that. Now, a great way of getting people to sign up for a free class is to do public workshops. And one of the big events in the county is the Rockville Science Day at Montgomery College. So we have a whole spread there, from digital modes all the way down to straight keys. And then, as the education guy, I see Field Day as an amateur radio, ham radio open house. I put announcements into the local newspapers, whether online or actual physical papers. And on occasion, I go to the local parks with new hams to show them. And invariably, somebody's curious, what is that buddy pole stick there? What is that stick there? So I'm ready for my little spiel. And the Marine Corps Marathon, for example, is a 30,000, maybe more, spectators, 28,000 people run. And there where I hang out, I'm ready for them. So that's the card that I have. It's a two-sided card. So to hams, I have a card on one side. It says W2LNX at ARL.net. But to non-hams, I have that. So I always have that ready. And this is an example of flyers that you can get for free. So did you know when you order a book or books from the ARRL, you can ask for packs of 25, no more than 4 at a time, to be thrown into the package. You may have to pay an incremental more for shipping. But that's all available. By the way, all these links, all these images, there's an image, are clickable. So when these get posted on the DCC website, you can search for these, for this presentation, and you can click on the image and you can get more information. So I want to point that out to the video audience. And in 2016, I went to the effort of getting an ad placed in the Washington Post. So the editor of the weekend section sent me back an email, what is this amateur radio thing? So I had to explain to her in one paragraph, succinctly and cogently, what amateur radio is. So there it is. So a friend of mine saw that in the paper and sent me a screenshot of that. So this was the ad for That was the ad for when we had the classes at Montgomery College. At the Science Center building. Now, we moved to the Rockville Memorial Library on the second floor. The library invited the Rockville Science Center folks who put on the Science Day to run a makerspace, gorgeous 2,000 square foot room. I can take off my hat now. And I was actually the first volunteer when there was an announcement for call for volunteers, because I saw that as an opportunity. Ham radio testing, education, workshops, we can solder there. So that's a screenshot of the ad. And the librarian is nice enough to run the registration list. So when people contact me, I collect a roster, and so does the librarian. And then a week before the event, in this case, this happened to be the soldering workshop, I have a roster. This is a screenshot, this is a photo of the in makerspace mode. And these are participants watching N4DR assembling an AM radio kit from Elenco, and there he is. So you can see, get an idea what the resources are. We have an inexpensive video camera, HD, $50, and a desk lamp that lights up the what Mark is doing. He's actually building the kit in real time, and people follow along. So the people who did this, who participated, never saw it before. And of course, we weren't shy about saying, hey, guess what? We're members of the Montgomery Amateur Radio Club, and we're going to be running a free class. Get your ham license. So how do you find a class? Well, very easily. If you type Google search, find amateur radio class, the ARRR website, typically the first one or the second one. So you do a search on that. Same thing. Montgomery County Public Libraries puts it up on their public calendars, and there we are. So what's our class like? 6 days, 6 Sundays, and I tell people the test is free, the class is free, and the ham license is free. So where's the cost? Well, it takes about 30 hours of travel time, drill and practice, reading, whatever it takes to get your ham license. We have a different instructor from the instructor team. I have about 9 people on the team who've presented. And these are all experienced hams who like to present. So they also tell war stories. They bring on their own personal experience, which is very interesting. And occasionally, they use words which people don't know. So I raise my hand and say, QRP means low power. Ham radio lingo. For example, the word Elmer, that means mentor in ham radio talk. We use the presentation visuals provided by the ARRL and their book. So since 2014, we had 196 students. 65 students earned their license, about a third. So like every good airline, you got to overbook. So I always overbook more than I have a number of seats in the classroom. And then I get worried, what if there isn't enough seating space? So it's never happened. But by the time they get to the second class, third class is whittled down to about half. And then about half those people take the test. And half the people who take the test, the people who do take the test, about 90% pass. So it's ultimately the people that do pass the test who get involved. And if we're lucky, we have one person who gets really involved, jumps in with both feet, joins the club, and they become fresh blood or fresh meat. So that's pretty exciting. So I say the lab portion of the class is public service events. I warn people, you have a learner's permit, your technician class license. What do you do with it? You actually have to go out in the field and do something with this. As an older ham, I have a lifetime accumulation of HTs, radios, HF radios. So equipment is certainly not a problem. Now, are adults as smart as middle school students? That's the question. So middle school students have no problem passing the technician test, but they have to study. This is a screenshot of the class the first day. And then as things whittle down, we bring out the folding table, the tables that fold over. So this is our syllabus, and so the common question I'm asked, why do you need to study for a license? And the answer is for safe and legal operation of amateur radio equipment, because you're allowed to use 1500 watts. And if you want to know what 1500 watts can do, take a steak, get a filet mignon, put it in a microwave oven and put it on high and stand back and see the mess, so you get an idea. 100 watts, 1,000 watts? Yeah, right, exactly. Personally, I never use more than 50 watts for everything. And I am a QRP digital guy myself, so I can relate. So this is the book. This is a great book because it's three books in one. Prep for the test and teaches a little radio theory and a little science, but here's the best part. You know, people ask me, what do I do with the book now that I'm done with it? Ah, that's where it gets interesting. So read it again. But from the point of view as a ham, and you have a catalog of ham radio activities that you can play with. So I'm not going to, you can read this yourself. As I said, this will be posted. But I make heavy use of Google Calendar. It's a calendar in the cloud. I would say I've been using it for over 10 years. In all those years, about two times I didn't have access to the calendar. That's pretty good. That's like, how many decimal places? Six sigma? It's very, you know, it's very reliable. Assuming I have internet, and I've really had failures when there were no blackouts. So this is what I use as a checklist. So at the beginning of the year, I mark everything in my Google Calendar, and it reminds me, and it duns me, did you do this? Did you send out the emails? I try not to use my mind as a memory device. It's not reliable 3 months hence. It just doesn't work. That's more of the checklist. So testing. Now, this is the interesting part. So I'm a member of the Laurel VEC and also ARRL VEC. So the way I tell my people to get certified as a Laurel VEC is very easy. You can get instantly certified as a VE, volunteer examiner, if you're a member of some other volunteer organization. So ARRL has the means where you can download their handbook or you can buy it and then read through the book. And then at the end, they have a open book test that you fill out and send it to them. And after 30 days, they'll send you your credentials with a lanyard. And then they send me a copy of the PDF file of their certificate, the VE certificate. It said, bingo, you're now a Laurel VE. And then I upload it to the Laurel VE manager website. So they're now officially part of the Laurel VE and then a member of my team. What I pointed out here is same thing, how to find the test. Finding amateur, so you do a Google search, finding amateur radio test, ham radio test, and that typically shows up. You can search in various ways. The Laurel VE has 34 states where they have tests. And this is the master list for every state. So you just search on two-letter code of your state, MD for Maryland, for example. And this is on the Montgomery Amateur Radio website. I have my list. So completely electronic. So I have people send me email, and I ask them to register, and I give them instructions how to register. But here's the secret sauce to make this work. So the ARRL was kind enough to put the Form 605 as a editable, is that an English word, editable, a PDF form that you can edit and fill in information, and then they email that to me, and I save it, and I will use that information. So let me talk a little bit about the Laurel VE Examiner Coordinator, the VEC. They've been around since 1984, and we're all volunteers. I could tell you this is a labor of love. And the chairman of the Laurel VEC is Diane Zimmerman, AA0OF, that's not a zero, and she answers to the FCC. So there are 14 VEC organizations, and the famous ones, of course, ARRL, W5YI, and there's other ones. Now, that's the Laurel VEC is subdivided into 10 area coordinators, and there are 167 Laurel VE teams in 34 states. We're a virtual organization. The only person I've actually met in person is my area coordinator, Bob Rose, A3RR. I met him at Dayton Hanvention. And so just some numbers. In 2016, they administered nearly 7,000 exams to a little over 5,000 applicants. So how do we do our work? We have a test generator website with the actual logo. But the best part is we use at the test session something called the session manager test software. allows us to enter our data. And that data is gleaned from this PDF form that people have sent me. So the only gotcha is being able to reliably copy and paste, not clipping things before or after a string of text. So I've gotten pretty good with that, but I also learned to proofread so you don't chop anything off. Email addresses that end in .co as opposed to .com sometimes don't work. So, and then there are tools that the area coordinator has to upload the test session information directly to the database and immediately get back a response. We also communicate with Google Group, announcements, discussions, and of course, email and telephone. So my team. So I have about 30 volunteer examiners, and it's the old 80-20 rule. So it seems to be the same six people, the same 10 people, eight people seem to do volunteer. And as I mentioned, I report to Bob Rose. I run six exams a year. And I also have a deputy. That's one of the things Bob Rose was telling us. Everybody needs to have an understudy. So in fact, Sunday afternoon, Dave is going to be running a test session. So I can't be two places at once. I'm just not that good. I typically run six volunteer examiners, three proctors and three graders. But the more important reason, if somebody gets sick, the show can still go on. I remember my very first VE test session. I asked for four. And sure enough, 2 days before the test session, somebody calls me up and says, look, I got a fever, I can't come. So I said, stay home. The show can go on. So it wasn't a problem. And since 2014, we've administered 16 test sessions, 288 applicants. We provide everything except the answers. We provide calculators, pens, pencils, erasers, scrap paper, but not the answers. And then, of course, those who get past their extra tests immediately get an email how to register and become a VE, because we like to be all extras so we can administer every single test. So, session manager software. So, the morning before, the day before you enter the data, copy and paste from the 605 into here, and we print at home on the big laser printer or at the test session, we print out these things. So when they pass their test, we print out a generated 605, everything all filled out, the test session, the date, everything. And all we need is 12 signatures, three signatures from the three VEs, plus, of course, the applicant, and another eight signatures for the two CSCEs, Certificates of Successful Completion, all filled out. That laser printer does not print in color, but you get the idea. And everything is fine. So that laser printer weighs 10 pounds. So I actually walked into Staples and I asked them, I need a laser printer that I can hold in one hand. Do you have anything like that? He said, sure, here. And it's a name brand, HP. Works very well. So what do we do with the results? We use Session Manager to encrypt the test session file with strong encryption. And it's a UU encoded text file, so you can actually look at the text. And then we email it. We email it to our area coordinator, in this case, Bob. And then he uploads it to the FCC database, and then immediately the FCC database returns a results file with the call signs, and then he replies to me, and then I notify the applicants. And the cool thing about this, when all the links are in place in the telecommunications and database chain, we can turn this around in one business day. So typically, Sunday afternoon, we're done with the test. Monday morning, go over the papers, make sure everything's correct. And I email it to Bob in the morning. He's he's in the Phoenix area. And then that evening, I have the results. And then I tell I tell my applicants what their call signs are. So we're actually proud of that. So again, this is a timeline. You can read this. If you're interested in how to doing it, this will give you a start. And I'm certainly available to answer questions. So, now comes the interesting part. So what happens, they have the ham license. what happens now. So certainly, we don't ask for donations, for a fee. We're completely completely free, the Laurel VEC, but we're not shy about mentioning that, hey, guess what? We're members of the local radio club, Montgomery Amateur Radio Club. But I tell people, the first question you should ask, where can I get involved? It's not like what's the first radio I should buy. It's like, what club should I join? So when people ask me about what HT or what radio, I say, that's a very good second question. But the first question that you should ask, where can I get involved? Because you need to get, you need to get experience. So I had an interesting problem. So I had a couple of young hams who got their general, and they asked me, and I already had known them from the first test, and also they joined the club. And they asked me, what radio do I buy? And I said, hold that thought. Where are you going to be that afternoon? I'm going to be at home. Great. So people have been giving me radios, and plus I have more radios than maybe shirts, pants, I don't know. I mean, what's that? No. No, we're talking about radios and computers. Oh, number of computers I have under the table, you don't want to know. Lifetime collection. All new at one point. Anyway, so this is an example of HF radios. We lend radios for 6 months. For example, this radio, there it is, the ICOM 718. Believe it or not, it's still in production. It's been out, what, 15, 20 years? Amazing. Fantastic first radio, easy to use. So we lend that, and we lend a complete station, including wires for the dipoles, everything that you need to get set up, get started. That we typically lend for 6 months. But when people give me really old equipment, good equipment, like, for example, the TS-430S is an example that was given to me by Al, KN3U. He said, find another home for it. And I said, okay, I'll take it. And sure enough, so I recently lent this to a brand new ham radio family. The mother, the father, and the child got their ham license. So I said, okay, so the rule with these radios is that this is an indefinite loan. I don't like giving things to people, but I'm certainly glad to lend people things. So this is on an indefinite loan. So what's an indefinite loan? You can use it for as long as you like. When you're done with it, or if it breaks, please return it. And you can't sell it, and you can't give it away. If you're done, please return it so we can pass it on. So now, and when some of these radios come back and it's time to find another candidate to borrow the radio, the understanding is now that you've learned how to use the radio, share your knowledge with the next person using the radio. It's a great way of building community. So the other thing is, students, I'm partial to young people. I mean, but you've got to do something to lower the average age of the ham radio population. So these are a couple of college students, Jameson K3SNR and Charlie KC3HTB, at mile marker 15 of the Marine Corps Marathon. I had mentioned that before. And of course, I have everything there. I once went to the marathon with an 18-foot MFJ antenna with a GP3 omnidirectional antenna, just for eye candy, because I like to do the dog and pony show. And sure enough, I was placed against a 20-foot brick wall where the highway was, and I couldn't get out. So I'm glad I had that antenna and that mask. So I learned that's what I always bring for public service events, even if I don't need it. Often, I like to go do demos in the park. Where I live, very densely populated, the background noise is S7, S8. DSP, Flex 5000s, Flex 6000 radios can only do so much with noise, but you can't fool Mother Nature. So go to the park where the background noise is about S2, S3, not bad. So this is Black Hill Regional Park, and this is a screenshot of the dog park area. That's great there, but there's no picnic tables, there's no shelters for people, but we have some trees, and where the balloon marks is the field, and we can set up antennas. I have a full size, enough pieces to put together a 20-meter full-size dipole at 18 feet, but you got to guy it down with rope, and I use 10-pound weights to support. I don't like putting stakes in the ground. And that works very well. But people sometimes come by. It is a public park, so I have my ham radio hat. This is what I wear when I do these events. And cards, flyers, and you know, you never know. People send me email that they're interested in taking, registering for the class. Another location is Sugarloaf Mountain. So a lot of hams spend many tens of thousands of dollars building these superstations, 199 feet tall antenna towers, plus the antenna on top. But I think I can do better than that. A short 20-minute hike from the west parking area up to the top of Sugarloaf gives me a 1,200-foot tall mast that we can set up on. So I like to operate QRP, so the KX2, and I use a buddy pole whip. It's a 5-meter rod with a bungee cord running through the segment, so I can snap it together in minutes and get set up very quickly in 15 minutes on the air. What I like about digital modes, narrowband, gives me the economy and the efficiency of Morse code, but the convenience of computer DSP decoding. So young kids, when they get their ham license, I have a gift for them. It's too bad this is out of print. This is a great book from the ARRL. So I buy them on Amazon and I have a stock of them. So I give this to kids, and also I give this, or sell it, depending on the circumstance, RTL SDR V3. Wow, this is a nice little radio. Price is right, $20. I think it was introduced at Dayton. The engineer flew in from New Zealand to talk about this. Nice fellow. I forgot his name.
Carl.
Oh, okay. Carl. I forgot his call sign. Sorry. Anyway, so this is a great little radio for the kids to start listening and get involved with radio. Now, what do you do with kids who get their general? I was a little uncomfortable lending an 11-year-old a 100-watt radio, 12-year-old 100-watt radio, but you know, a lot of hams got their start in 11 or 12, and you know, that's an unfounded fear. But you know, this is a radio for $50 with $9 shipping from India, so they sell it as a semi-kit. It is a one-board radio with a handful of pots, variable resistors, and wires with connectors to plug into the headers on the board, and all they need to do is mount it in the box. So I've given one child this, and I'm waiting to see if Jack passes his test on. And you'll see a picture of Jack momentarily on Sunday. I'm confident he will. I'm absolutely confident that he will. He's a very smart young man. So there we are at the Kid Museum. So I'm also the trustee of the KM3 KID amateur radio station. So my goal was to replace myself, you know, 10, okay. My goal was to replace myself with qualified, certified, trained operators who look like the target audience. It's kind of hard to find, you know, hams with 50 years experience who look like an 11-year-old, so you have to train them. So there is Joshua, KC3ICM, who has his general now, and I'm teaching him how to use the Tentec Omni 5. He wandered into my November test, so I asked him, how did you, you know, who put you up to this? He says, oh, I found you on the web. Oh, really? So I needed to adopt him and his, you know, and his parents. So and he's gotten quite involved. So once a month we go to the Kid Museum, but I want to go there once a week with a whole team of kids, 11, 12, 13 years old, operating the station. So maybe tomorrow, Sunday afternoon, I'll have two kids ready to be on this team. Here we are. There's Jack, another young man, KC3JML, who also wandered into my test. And so I adopted him and his father. I haven't met his mother yet. And they're really excited with digital modes. So they are. This is the actual live shot. This was not posed. This is actually happening in real time. So Bob Ekman, who runs the Rockville Science Center, who was contacted to set up the makerspace in the Rockville Memorial Library, wanted, or, you know, scheduled a electronics workshop at the Bullis School, a summer camp program, but he needed an instructor, so he asked me, because, you know, Ham's there hanging out in his space, would we be willing to do it? So I asked my mentor, Richard WN3R, if he would like to do it. And so he said, yes, he would. But so I said, fine, I'll volunteer. But due to circumstance, I took over responsibility and he became my volunteer. So there he is. So we worked there together, and there we were having a ball at the electronics camp. So since we're hams, we have a communications, radio communications, wireless communications bend to this. So we actually built, they had three major projects. The first one is building an AM radio kit, the Elenco AM780K. So in quantities of 10, you can get it for $10 a piece. So I buy them 10, 20 at a time. And so they have an AM radio. So that's one project. And they also learn how to solder. And we're happy to fix the radios that they mess up. And the other project that they build is an audio oscillator with an on-off switch. So 555 chips. I think they still sell like a billion of these a year. And so that oscillates about 800 hertz. And then the third project is an RF oscillator, similar circuit using the 555, and that can oscillate up to 1.5 megahertz. Oh, wow, so half of that is right in the middle of the AM band. So the last final project, the fourth project, is to connect the wire between the two, oscillators, and then using the on-off switch, using a push button to key the audio oscillator so they can hear the tone coming out of the AM radio. And they get so excited. And then, of course, we have, I bring my KX2 and my flexible buddy whip antenna, and we have QSOs in digital mode. So the first time we did the camp, we did it twice, we had a contact from Maryland, in the Rockville area, down to Georgia, I think Athens, Georgia, and another one up to Maine. So the kids get excited about that. So there's one child there, sat there for 2 weeks, very polite, wasn't engaged, wasn't involved, didn't do anything, just sat there. Didn't make any trouble. But when he saw that demo, he got very excited, and he said, wow, that's really cool. And I said, bingo, I reached them. So these are the moments I live for. Now, a couple of success stories. So, oh boy, he's going off to graduate school this is Aaron Solomon, KEB3MLM. He is going off to graduate school, University of Cambridge, Cambridge University. It's the one where Newton hung out some years ago, that one. So he's studying, he majored in biology from Honors College at University of Maryland. And when he was around 11, I did a public demo with my HT, and he's very curious, what is this? So one thing led to another, he got his ham license. And then I actually met him recently, a couple of weeks ago, when his mother put on a bon voyage party and asked him, so how did ham radio change your life? I says, oh, well, that gave me a creative outlet for my technical interests. And that led to getting involved with the production, a video production studio in his hometown in Greenbelt, Maryland. And one thing led to another, he was just an A student. So ham radio doesn't change lives. And I actually have another story. This is more recent. This is Valerie, KC3, HPJ, also going off to the Honors College, University of Maryland, as an electrical engineering student, and she got a scholarship, $2,000 scholarship from the ARRL, and she showed up about a year and a half ago saying she'd like to get her ham license and like to volunteer. So, wow. I also realized from my class is that you students, anybody can volunteer with me, because I'm the control operator. So they use my call sign. So this, not having a license yet is not an issue. So she was able to qualify for a very competitive position as an intern at the Kid Museum. They take one out of three or one out of four for that position for the summer. That's what she did. And then, of course, she got into the Honors College. So that's another success story. And so if you want to know about building a team, if you're interested. By the way, this is the right audience that I'm addressing. This is maybe not software engineering, but this is community engineering. You're dealing, and actually the components, the relationships, they are much more, a little bit more complicated than bits and bytes and if statements. You know, they're always going to work the right way. So number one takeaway, take ownership. You know, talk is cheap. If you want to do something, you want to, whatever it is you want to do, take ownership. And one of my guiding principles is that just because you don't know how to do something is not a reason, it's not a reason not to do it. You'll figure it out. You'll get volunteers if you announce an event, who, what, when, and where, and for how long. Now, if some people want to help you organize things, by all means, you delegate responsibility and authority, but keep an eye on things, follow up, make sure it happens. Thank you, volunteers. Give them lunch. Express gratitude. Can't thank people enough. And if you think it takes you so much time to organize something, at least twice as long. This is conservative. This is actually very generous. This is always longer than that. I've always lamented, and I never have time to work on technical projects. You know, there's cool stuff out there. It seems to suck up all my time, but I'm glad I'm doing this. It's a numbers game. You got to do this a lot. So I actually have a 10-year plan to do this, and then I'm going to pass it on to the next person. And follow up. Any inquiries, any emails, you got to follow up. Otherwise, you wasted everybody's time. Now, if you're working with children, you really got to educate the parents. You got to have their buy-in. Otherwise, it's not going to happen. And so a lot of thank yous. So I'm running out of time, so I'm going to skip that. But there it is. And conclusion. So this is really important work. And it is a way of sharing and giving back, and certainly is for me. Because ham radio has been kind to me. And now, 50 years later, after I've been introduced to ham radio, somebody gave me a book, So You Want to Be a Ham, 50 years ago. And here we are. So now I'm giving out books. And I want to remember Professor Uche Abanulo, KC3ARX, who signed for me for classrooms at Montgomery College. And she died recently. Young woman, 35, survived by 3 children. And our husband, very sad. But anyway, I want to remember her. So any questions? Question, yeah.
I have to say, I'm really impressed by the one business day turnaround. A lot of us got word of our original license from the little print shop who managed to get into the FCC database back in the day, and you would get this letter with your QSL order form and your call sign on the front of it, and you would look at that envelope and you go, oh my God, it's my call. So anyway, that's very good. I have a actual question. Do you guys track question by question success in the exams? Can you tell what questions are more difficult, what are answered incorrectly most often, or do you have any kind of tracking program that that points out what the issues are with the training materials and the tests? Thank you.
That's a really good question. No, we don't. But in addition to preparing a test session file that I sent to my area coordinator, I also send all the paperwork. So by regulation, we need to archive these for, I think, 7 years. So that information is available. Every test question every test has a form number. So I like to have 8 versions of the same test. And of course, the answer sheet has the code of the test booklet. So that data is available. But we personally, you know, I haven't done that. But the information is available if one's willing to take the time to mine that.
Any other questions? Well, thank you very much, David. I really appreciate that talk. Who else has got lightning talks? Okay, here's another lightning talk. I've gotten 3, 4. All right, this is going to be a real challenge. I think I'm going to make this as part of the DCC going forward in the future.
Thank you,
where
sir.
We'll set aside some time. What do you guys think? We got seven talks, okay. So I think this is a great addition to the DCC. What do you guys think? Okay.